And what we've got here is 10 sets of weeds, same set on both sides. And what I'm asking you in this exercise is to challenge your power of observation. And it's not about if you know the weed, it's read the description and you tell me what you're seeing. And you tell me whether it's A or B or C, or whether it's A and B, or whether it's A, B, and C. Okay? So anybody who doesn't have some pen or a pen, I have some extra pens here as well. And like I said, it's the same set on both sides, so you can just spread out and work through it, and then after about 10 or 12 minutes, we'll take up the whole list here. So the first thing we wanted to look at was an ochrea. And an ochrea is an important ID characteristic of the smartweed family. All members of the smartweed family have an ochrea. And I had a little picture here to show you what that feature was. So when we looked at 1A, some people may recognize it. It's a bindweed plant. Bindweed does not have an ochrea, so it's not A. But B, if you look at it closely, it's very small, but it does have an ochrea. This is prostrate knotweed. So B is the right answer. But if you look at C, you may think I've got another bindweed here, but in fact, it's not. It has an ochrea as well. So C is the right answer. This is sheep sorrel. Sheep sorrel, again, a member of the smartweed family, could easily be confused. Now, it's not as difficult to control as bindweed, but my point here again is it looks like bindweed, but it's not. And this is the case with a lot of weeds. They mimic one another for whatever reason. But you can be confused if you don't investigate fully. So again, it has the ochrea, so it makes it part of the smartweed family. So B and C are part of that family. Now another thing that comes to mind is counting leaves, and we think about the era of the glyphosate, GMO type herbicides we have, but we still have a lot of other herbicides that we still have to rely on. There's a application window where the proper control is attained at a certain leaf stage. So we have to know what that leaf stage is. And the correct answer for the four leaf stage was A, and that is the witchgrass here. Now, when we're looking at the second flat, these plants are actually not that big, but in fact, they're about 8 to 10 leaf. So they are maybe beyond the capacity of some of the herbicides that might be used to control them. And C, which is interesting as well, again, not a very big plant, but this particular plant is at the 6 leaf stage. So again, small plants, and a good example of plants reacting to their environment. I'm thinking this year, I like to call it a signature year because it's a year that people will never forget because of the extreme May we had. Well, going back in time, and for some of you who may be not in the industry at the time, but 1988 was a signature year as well. Because for those of you who were working at that time or farming, remember the extreme conditions that we had. Extreme heat and extreme drought. And the plants reacted accordingly. So in the case of lamb's quarters, the lamb's quarters were very small, but they continued to grow. And the distance between the nodes was very short. So you had plants that were 10 to 12 leaf, but were only this big. And the problem was that people thought, even though you had a small plant, you could still control it with the herbicides of the day. The problem was the window of opportunity had already passed, plus those plants were hardened off because of the extreme heat. And the control, even though applied when the plant was small, was definitely less than satisfactory, and reapplication was used, and again, people spent a lot of money and didn't get good results. But again, that window of opportunity had passed because those plants were in too large a leaf stage for the herbicide to work properly. Now, the running theme that I have through the rest of this is similar plants, but distinctly different. And in this case, I want you to find one of the plants, or the plant, that had no hairs. So when we look at A, these plants look somewhat similar. Maybe they look like dandelions. But when we look at the surface, there are small hairs. In fact, this is prickly lettuce. And when we think of prickly lettuce, it has spines along the back, but when you look here, you really don't see any spines. So they're very, very microscopic, but they are there. But at a glance, you may not think that it's prickly lettuce. But because it has those hairs on the upper surface, it in fact is. Whereas this plant here, this is dandelion. Dandelion is hairless. So the correct answer was B. So again, they could be confused, but because of those intermittent hairs, you can tell. So this is a fall scouting expedition. These are plants as they would appear in probably late September, early October. So because weed scouting goes on in the spring and in the fall. Versus C, these plants again look like they could be little dandelions, but in fact they're quite hairy. This is Canada fleabane, as it would appear in the fall. Now, four, again, very small weeds, but a distinct difference. And we're actually telling you that we're looking for scentless camomile. We're actively searching it out. And what we're looking for is a plant that has a finely divided leaf, and it has orbicular or round cotyledons. And cotyledons are an important structure on broadleaf plants that are used for identification. So we have the first two samples, and they both have finely divided leaves. So when we look a little closer at the cotyledons of this one, they are elongated, so they're eliminated. This is wild carrot, but again, the leaves look somewhat similar. So when we look at B, a finely divided leaf, and when we dig down, we can definitely see those little orbicular cotyledons. So B was the correct answer. But we also have C here, and it has a divided leaf. Now, I did underline finely divided, so it's not as divided and divided again as this one is. But the one thing we do notice is that it does have orbicular cotyledons as well. So in the case of this description, only B fits the description.
What's that one?
This, and we're going to talk about it right here.
Sorry,
no problem. This is biennial wormwood. Now, biennial wormwood is a plant that it's only really new to us. It's been around a long time. It goes back decades to when this particular area and many areas like it had mixed farming, where we had a larger amount of pasture area, and people had cattle on their farm, and then sheep, whatever, pigs outside. But then as conventional tillage took over and people became more towards just running a corn and bean operation and just having conventional tillage, plants like biennial wormwood disappeared because they are more suited to a non-tilled environment. But then we went to no-till, and no-till is very well suited to biennial wormwood. So it reappeared. It never really went away. It just didn't have an opportunity to prosper. So now we see more biennial wormwood showing up. And so we are looking for a plant that is divided leaf and has an orbicular cotyledon, but it's also hairless. So A fits the bill, and when we look at it closely, there's no hair, and again, those orbicular cotyledons. But when we compare it to B, this flat here, they look very similar. A divided leaf, orbicular cotyledons, and I think a lot of people recognize this as ragweed, and this is where the problem has begun. Ragweed and biennial wormwood at this stage are very, very similar. And the big difference is, again, the hair. There is hairs on the leaves and stem of common ragweed. The biennial wormwood is hairless. So they will continue to look alike until about the 6 to 8 leaf stage. And then biennial wormwood will actually grow in a very tight whorl and grow up to a height of up to 2 meters, about 6 feet. And it looks like Canada fleabane. So it mimics other plants, and this is where another reason why it's a problem, because again, it's misidentified, and people are applying applications for the wrong weed to try to obtain the same results. So this is where identification becomes important, because without it, you're not going to get proper control. So I also threw in wild carrot again, because it is a divided leaf, but again, those elongated cotyledons make it not the sample. So the correct answer was A. Now, number six was a bit of a trick question. And what I wanted to show you, or at least ask you, was pigweeds all have a notched leaf as they grow. So which of these flats have that? In fact, A, B, and C have that characteristic. So A, B, and C is the right answer. But we have red root pigweed, we have green pigweed, and we have water hemp. Now, the pigweed populations that we have, we do have small pockets scattered about the province that are showing resistance to different herbicide groups in both red and green. It doesn't mean that the whole population is resistant, it's just that it's scattered populations. Whereas water hemp, luckily, we don't have any more than two known populations in the province. But in fact, this one, we don't want to have it spread, because there is documented evidence of a huge amount of herbicide resistance to a number of different herbicide groups. And again, we only have it in a couple of places. So how do we tell the difference? We have to wait until these plants can just get a little bit bigger. Red root pigweed will have a significant amount of hair along the stem. Green pigweed will have some hair, and the water hemp will be hairless. And as the water hemp grows, it will have a more paddle-shaped leaf, and it'll get quite tall as well. So, and the other thing about water hemp is that it has male and female plants. So the potential for the gene pool that's creating progeny, is tremendous. So we can have a huge amount of possibilities, and that's why we see herbicide resistance within that particular species of plant. Now, if anybody got this one wrong, you better go back to Weed ID school. But it's an important thing to know. We're looking for plants with an opposite leaf, and I think it was pretty obvious. A, opposite leaves, versus B, which may look opposite, but when you look at it individually, we've got alternate leaves. And in fact, if you look at the little water hemp plants here, you might have noticed that one leaf is bigger than the other. And in fact, when the first leaf comes out, we only see one leaf, not two. That tells you that these leaves are growing alternately. They're growing at a different rate. So you already know that this plant has an alternate leaf arrangement because of that. Number eight, and that is the power of smell. Not all plants have odor, but a significant amount do. And it's an important identification thing that we can use to our advantage. When we're looking at the set of trays, we had two plants that are hairless. Dandelion, and we also have pennycress. But if you sniffed C, some of you hopefully could detect an odor, that rank kind of garlic-like smell. And that's quite prominent in, these plants have been kind of beat up, so they might have lost some of their smell. But anyway, there is a definite odor to stinkweed or pennycress. In fact, if dairy cattle ingest this in a significant amount, they can actually transfer the smell from the plant into the milk byproducts that are produced. So definitely something that we want to keep away from dairy cattle in particular. Versus B, what we have here, we have some plants, again, that look similar, but if in a closer inspection, this is shepherd's purse and it has hair on the upper surface of the leaf. Now, let's put these models to the side for a second. Again, a simple question, but people are often intimidated by trying to identify grasses. And the simple question here was, find me the grass that is hairy on both sides and has a twisted leaf. Now, all the grasses are hairy, but only one truly has a twisted leaf. B looks like it's twisted, but on an individual basis, it's not. It's C. C is downy brome. Now, downy brome is kind of a unique grass in the fact that it grows as a winter annual. And when I say a winter annual, this is a plant that starts in the fall, lives through the winter, and completes its life cycle in the spring. And you'll see downy brome now along the sides of roads and in fields, hay fields, wheat fields. This large brown plant with a drooping panicle that is brown. Its life cycle is over and it's ready to shed its seeds and start again this fall. So kind of a unique grass for that reason. Now, these little models here that we have, this is something that we're going to try and use to teach students how to identify grasses. And they look kind of crude, but actually they're a good learning tool, because any of you that have, when you first try to learn about grasses and ligules and things like that, it's a little intimidating to try and find those structures. But when you have something large you can actually see, you can see the membranous ligule, where it's located. You can see the hairy ligule, where it's located, the sheath, the blade, and all the different structures of a grass. And then once you've got that in your head, you can transfer over to here and you know exactly what you're looking for. And so anybody who's doing in-house training, this is a good little simplistic tool that you could use to help train people to identify grasses. Now, the last group that I have, I wanted to know how many foxtails there are. And in fact, there are five different types of foxtails in Ontario. The obvious ones are green, yellow, and giant. But we have two others that you may not know about. The other one is bristly. And bristly foxtail looks like green foxtail, except when the seed head comes out, the seed heads get tangled like Velcro. Yeah. The other one, is a biotype of green foxtail, and it's called giant green foxtail. It grows as tall as giant, and as it matures, it turns to a purple hue, and even the seed head has some purple in it. But for all intents and purposes, it is just a green foxtail that is very large. It's a biotype. But just to make you aware of that, if you see it out in some of your travels.
Okay, any quick questions for Dave? We got to move on. Okay, thank you very much, Dave.